In the last two lectures, I have talked about the fundamental aspects related with the fusion welding. In this lecture, basically, I will be talking about three, four things. The one is about the choice of joint. Choice of joining or welding approach to be used. So what are the factors we should consider while deciding the type of joining process we should go for? Like in the last lecture, I talked about the two aspects. One was the power density related with the fusion welding process and the approach being used for protecting the weld pool from the atmospheric gases for so that the clean weld can be developed. And each joining process, each fusion welding based process offers the unique the power density and so the capability to deliver the heat input. Higher the power density, lower will be the heat input that is required for developing a fusion weld joint from a given process. This is one thing. And the second thing was what approach is being applied by a particular fusion welding process to protect the weld pool. So there were inactive gas or inert gas shielding, then there was vacuum or molten slag. So there are three, four approaches are there. So due to the difference in the power density and due to the difference in the shielding approach being used in a particular welding process, the weld quality is different. And therefore, we get the different performance of the weld joint being developed by the different processes. Okay, so here, as far as this choice of the joining process, this is first thing about which we have to talk, and thereafter we'll go into the how the joint is developed. So what are the different types of the joints and how do we distinguish them? And then this is little tricky only, the types of weld. You see, the types of joint is about the way by which the plates or the components have been arranged with respect to each other for development of the joint. That's about the orientation and relative positions. And types of the weld means the what, how the weld metal is being deposited, and what is its location. So that indicates or that decides the types of the weld. So these are the two different things, types of weld and types of joints. Thereafter, we'll also try to see the welding positions. You see, depending upon the location, orientation, where the weld is to be made, there are different welding positions which make the welding either easier or difficult. So that dictates the kind of precautions we should use while developing the joint. And if we have to develop the joint of very thin sheet, thick sheet of the pipes, plates, tubes. So for joining the components of the different shapes, configurations and sizes, the weld is made using the the different types of the groove preparations. So you can say the types of the groove or you can say edge preparation which is needed. About that also we'll try to talk. And lastly, if we find the time, then we'll see the classification of the welding processes. Okay, so these are the different aspects about which we have to talk. So starting with the first one, like the factors which will be dictating the choice of the welding approach or the joining approach. So basically it depends on the certain factors which we should consider. So you can say simply the selection of the joining approach. So the first here is what kind of load carrying capacity we are looking for. Load carrying capacity. So how you will understand this? Say the base metal, this is having the strength of 400 MPa. So whether you want the joint of the strength matching with this 400 or it will be okay even if it is 200, okay, because it is minimum expected, maximum expectation from a joint that it matches with the base metal performance. But for a given situation, if it is okay to have the lower strength also, then it should be fine. Like you can go ahead with even lower load carrying capacities, because all joints may not be the structural joints which will be taking the load during the service or during the performance. So matching strength is fine, but even lower strength may also be okay. So you may accept like 50% joint strength is also fine. That's how we are determining 100 joint is a weld strength and 100 base metal, 400 base metal strength and 400 weld joint strength. So in that case you'll see joint efficiency is 100%, and if the weld strength is 200 and the base metal strength is 400, then joint efficiency is 50%. Simple. So what kind of the load carrying capacity that we are looking for in terms of the MPa or the toughness or the hardness or any other mechanical property which we are interested in. Okay, so this is one. The second aspect we should consider is the reliability. No, reliability, like how guaranteed performance will be given by a joint. Means if there is a huge risk, making a joint offering you huge risk of life and property, then certainly you will be trying to develop a joint which is highly reliable and the tendency for the failure is negligible. So these kind of the joints, like the joints used in the reactors. Now if there is a failure of the reactor, then you see lot of the radiations will be spreading around and lot of loss of life can be there. Similarly, the aircrafts or spacecrafts. So all these, if there is a failure of the one, then the huge loss of the life as well as property will be taking place. So you have to consider like which joint will be reliable and will not fail, because the different joints will offer you the different degree of reliability, because there is always some kind of compromise with the joint, the base metal properties when a joint is developed, especially in case of fusion welding. Okay, so you have to ensure that even in the long term, under the severe conditions, like in petrochemical industry, your huge lengthy pipelines will be running through the offshore also, and same thing is true for your nuclear reactors. So the point here is how much risk is involved and what type of the joints are needed. So based on that you take a call, like which method of joining should be used. Like in nowadays in all racing cars or even newer variants of Audi and Mercedes, they are using a lot of solid state joining as compared to that of the fusion based joining, because somehow the performance is badly compromised. The performance of the base metal is badly compromised when the fusion joint is developed. So it is preferred, like even if we can develop a joint even in the solid state without compromising on the weight, without addition of the weight, because in like aircrafts, in automotives, the weight is very crucial. You want to make the things without increasing the weight. And most of the joining where filler metal is to be applied, if the filler metal is added, then there will be increase of weight. So we want to have the joint, but without any addition to the weight. And that's where the solid state joining plays a very good role. And without that also develops the joint without compromising without much compromise in the base metal properties or the properties of the material itself of which component is made. Okay, so the reliability is the second part. Third point here is the compatibility. So compatibility means like if A is to be joined with the A, then there is no problem because both are the same composition, same physical, chemical, metallurgical, mechanical, thermophysical properties, both are having the same. So they are going to behave in a similar manner, and if both will be behaving in a similar manner, probably the issues related with the joining, whether it is solid state or fusion, those will be limited. But the problem arises especially when you are dealing with the dissimilar metals, like A is completely different from B in terms of chemical properties, physical properties, mechanical properties, and metallurgical properties. So if that is the case, the two are brought together, then they pose lot of issues in the development of joint. So the joint may not be strong, joint may not be tough, joint may be very crack sensitive. So you will find that performance is not good. So there are certain methods. So you may not be able to use the fusion based approaches in such situations, when there is a compatibility issue between the two metals to be joined. So what we prefer to go for, like let us use something where there is no metallurgical connection or limited metallurgical interactions between the two is taking place. Okay, so your solid state joining based approach or high energy or high power density based processes, where the limited melting or very less melting is taking place both the sides and leading to the development of joint without much of the metallurgical interactions and the related issues. Okay, so the compatibility between the two metals also need to be considered while taking a call on the kind of joint process or approach to be used. Like I have said, the mechanical joints are very reliable. Nuts, bolts, rivets, clamps, etc. But they contribute towards the weight addition, increase in weight of the component. So these are not really preferred for the automotive, aircraft, and wherever the dead weight is very important. And the second is the adhesives. The adhesives, they are really, the problem with these adhesives is they are like epoxies, Fevicol, M-Seal, etc. The problem with these is that they are not very strong. They do not sustain under the harsh conditions of the temperature and weather, and so the performance, these are not good for very severe conditions, and the strength offered is also very limited. And therefore the fusion welding joints are good in terms of the strength, but the reliability is not good, and you need to look into the various technological aspects to see that joint gives the desired, not just mechanical performance, but also the reliability is also good. Means under the harsh conditions and during the long service, means the desired life, they give the desired life without compromising the performance. Like if there is an aircraft maybe 20 years old, like there is a reactor that may be 40 years old. So still if the joint is there, the reliability and the tendency for the failure should be a minimum. Otherwise there is going to be huge disaster in terms of the life and the property. So it is important to consider some of these points. Apart from these, certainly the economy certainly governs the choice of the joints, but many times for the critical cases we don't worry much about the cost. We go for the things which will be giving the performance in terms of the desired surface properties, desired and the reliability as well. Okay, so that was about your the factors those need to be considered for selection of the joints. Then coming to the types of the joints. Okay, types of joints. So the types of the joint, this we'll try to see like the how the components to be joined have been arranged or placed with respect to each other, placed with respect to each other. So that will be deciding the type of the joint we are going to make. Let's say I'll give just a simple example, like this is the plate, okay, and similarly there is another plate. Okay, so in front view, if you see, the plate will look like a rectangular sheet like this, and another plate of the similar kind if placed like this, when both the plates are in the same level, same position, then this will be the abutting position, you can say abutting positions. When the end to end or edge to edge of the plate are in line and they are in the same plane, so there is a edge to edge connection and they are in the same plane, but this is called abutting position. So when the components to be joined are placed like this, this will be leading to the butt joint. Okay, this is the butt joint. When the components to be joined are one plate or one component is placed over the another one like this, so one plate is above the other one. Okay, so this is A and this is B, and joint has to be, now we can make the joint here, we can make the joint here, in both the cases. So but when the one plate is overlapping the other for developing a joint, that's the kind of placement of the two component, then we call it as a lap joint. Okay, and when the two components to be joined are placed in such a way that their corners need to be, so this is one plate, this is another plate, and their corners are coming close to each other, and here the joint is developed. This is one typical way of developing joint, but like this we can develop number of joints. So this kind of the connection means the corner of one component is matching with the other one, and then joint is being made. This is called corner joint. Okay, so the butt joint, lap joint, corner joint. So when we put the two components having the like they are almost, their surfaces are almost parallel, but deviation between these two can be up to 5 degree, but they are almost parallel, and the joint is developed, the edges are joined together by putting in the fillet, putting in the metal at the edge, or by making a groove and then filling up the metal. So in this case, say one plate made a groove like this, and another plate groove is made like this. Okay, and then here we fill. So this is like groove is being filled with the weld, molten metal. So this type of the joint, when the weld is made at the edges of the plates to be joined, which are almost parallel, or maximum angular position between the two is up to the 5 degree. So this is called, this type of the joint is called edge joint. Okay, so the butt joint, lap joint, corner joint, and the lastly, depending upon the position how the two have been placed, the one plate in horizontal position and another in vertical position, and this is forming a T type of structure, inverted T you can say. So this is the vertical plate and the horizontal plate, and forming the T configuration. So this is known as T joint. So these are the five the common types of the joints which are made: butt joint, lap joint, corner joint, X joint and T joint. Okay, now coming to the, this is about the different types of the requirements in which the joints are to be made. So we can categorize these connections as the different types of the joints. Then the types of the weld, like it, this classification is based on that how and where the weld metal is deposited. How and where the weld metal is deposited. So if you want to understand this, let us see these four. There are four types of the weld. One is groove, the second is the fillet, third is the plug, and fourth is the bead. So let me show you. You make the two plates like this, and there is no edge preparation. The ends is, edges are perfectly square and machined, and fill the metal in between these two to develop the joint. This is used for thin sections. But when section is thick, you have to prepare the edges like this. You have to cut the edges so that there is a V groove kind of the configuration, and then you fill the gap between the two using the filler metal. Another example, like I just gave you the one plate and the another plate to be joined. So the groove you are making just one side here in this case. So groove is made, this is a straight square, and here this is groove is being made, and then you fill it with the molten metal like this. So this way the plates will be running, and here and the weld metal will be filled in. So this all these are the examples of the groove weld. This is a simple square groove, then you can say V groove or bevel groove like this. So depending upon the geometry, we have the different types of the groove geometries. So but since we are talking about the groove types of the weld, so here we make a groove, and then that groove is filled in so that you can you have very good control over the through thickness penetration, and the weld is made throughout the thickness of the component to be made. In a fillet weld, it is just at the corner metal is filled in, like say in the lap joint like this, the metal is filled here or here. In T joint also, like so this is the T joint configuration, what we do, we make a fillet, so metal is filled in here, so partial melting, little melting in the both the base metals will be taking place like this. So this is called fillet weld. So in edge welding also, like fillet weld, I had told you the two plates are almost parallel, and you fill in the metal here, so little melting this side will be taking place. So this is an example of, these are the example of the fillet welds. Okay, then the plug weld is very interesting. So in plug weld, what we do, like say in the front view, this is the bottom plate, okay, and this is the top plate. So this is mostly used in the lap welding. So in the top plate, what we do, we try to make the hole like this, and then this hole is filled with the molten metal. So when the molten metal is filled in, so little melting will be taking place here. So that's how the connection is being made here. I'll make and when you see it in the top view, so and say this is the bottom plate is little bigger than the top plate. So in top plate we are making hole first, okay, like this, and then we will be depositing at the bottom here. The metal will be deposited at the bottom, so weld metal is deposited at the bottom like this. So it can be circular. When the circular hole is made, we call it as a plug weld, and when the hole made on the top plate is square, then we call it as a slot weld. Okay, and then here in the plug weld, weld metal deposited at the bottom like this at all the corners. So still the hole is left here. Similarly, in the rectangular slot, the at the bottom, the weld metal is deposited like this all around the periphery in case of the slot weld. Okay, as far as the bead weld is concerned, it is very simple. This is primarily used for the hard facing, like you want to develop this metal is really of the low hardness. It is a and for a given surface condition, if the surface you want it is harder, then we develop a weld bead of the hard material at the top surface like this. If you want that top surface is of the better corrosion resistant, because it will be exposed to the corrosive atmosphere like acidic or basic or saline water, accordingly we choose a suitable material and we develop the one layer of the weld metal over this surface of the base metal. So this is low quality material and the high quality material is deposited at the surface. Okay, so the because the functionality of a component will be governed by the surface properties. If the surfaces are of the good quality, then they will perform better. So let's say the top view of this kind of plates, you will be depositing the weld bead this way one by one to cover the entire surface area. So your entire the all the weld bead on the surface will be, so the entire surface area of the base metal will be covered by such kind of the good quality material. So this is used for the variety of purposes. When the purpose of developing the weld bead is to increase the hardness for good wear resistance, then it is called hard facing. When it is used for improving the corrosion resistance, then we deposit thick layer and then it is called cladding. And when you find that your component has lost its dimensions and you want to restore the dimensions, then you develop over the worn out component, you develop the weld metal and then you machine it out so that the dimensions are restored, and that process is called reclamation. Reclamation or refurbishing. Reclamation for restoring the dimensions, for improving the corrosion resistance when you deposit the good thick quality thick material layer, thick layer of the material, then called cladding, and for increasing the hardness and wear resistance we call it as hard facing. So the weld bead is deposited for the multiple purposes. Okay, so that was about the types of the weld. Types of the welds. Now coming to the welding positions, it is required to develop the weld joint in different positions. So that is about like where the plates have been placed like this. Okay, the two plates to be joined are perfectly in the same level and then weld is made like this. So they are in horizontal position. The plane on which the plates to be joined are in abutting position in horizontal plane. So this is called flat welding or downhand welding. Downhand welding or flat welding. Okay, the plates to be joined or the components to be joined, like say that the one tube is to be joined with another tube and they are in the same plane. So same horizontal plane. So that's called this is called flat welding. Okay, now so after the flat welding or downhand welding, we have the horizontal welding. This is little tricky. Horizontal welding, the plates are kept, the component to be joined are kept in the vertical plane like this. Okay, like this, and the weld line is horizontal like this. So the components to be joined are kept in vertical position. Okay, and then the joint is made like this. The plane of the developing weld is horizontal, but the position in which the plates to be joined, that is vertical. So the plate or the component position is vertical, but the weld is made horizontal like this. Okay. And in vertical welding, the plates are kept in the vertical, in the vertical welding, the plates to be joined are kept in the vertical position like this only. So the plates to be joined are kept in the vertical position like this. But the joint line here is also vertical. Here the joint line was horizontal, and these are the components to be joined are kept in the vertical. Okay, and this is the joint line, and the weld is made in the vertical direction. So the welding direction is also vertical, and the component orientation is vertical. So the vertical plane for the plates as well as the welding direction, both are vertical. Now you can move top to bottom or bottom to top, that is a different thing. That's about the where from you are starting and where you are ending. So not just the plates are in welding position, but the weld line is also vertical. But in the horizontal welding, plates are in vertical position, but the weld line is horizontal. Okay. And in overhead position, fourth one is the overhead welding. Overhead welding is just like doing the welding on the ceiling from in the room at the corners. So wherever your the weld metal to be deposited is above the head. Okay, so you can say the typical example is here. Your axis looks direction is this, and you have to deposit the metal here. Or so here above the head or at the corners here. So if that is the case, where the weld metal is to be deposited above the head, and here in this case the problem is weld metal will always be trying to fall down because it is the molten metal which is being deposited and being placed and being placed against the gravity, no? So molten metal will tend to fall down. So the falling down tendency is there in all these cases, but maximum in overhead welding, somewhat less in case of the vertical welding, further somewhat less in horizontal welding, and there is no tendency for falling down of the molten metal in the flat welding. So easiest control and the deposition of the molten metal is possible in the flat welding or downhand welding, somewhat more difficult in the horizontal welding, where the planes to be welded are in a vertical plane but the weld line is horizontal. Okay, and furthermore difficult is in the case of vertical welding position, where both welding direction as well as the plates, orientation of the plates, both are vertical. And in the overhead welding, the metal is to be deposited is above the head, and in the bottom side, you can say the metal is to be deposited in the ceiling in the room, just like that. So the maximum tendency of the molten metal to fall down will be there in the overhead welding, and that will make the welding very difficult. You need a lot of expertise to deposit the metal in and develop the joint in case of the overhead welding. Okay, so obviously we would like to see that the surface tension of the molten metal is high, so that it doesn't fall down easily, and to have the high surface tension and high viscosity of the molten metal, it is important that the temperature is low. So the low heat input processes are used for developing the weld joint in overhead and vertical positions, so that the falling tendency of the molten metal from the weld zone, that is minimized. Okay, now coming to the different types of the groups that are prepared for developing the
joint. So the groove preparation, or this is also known as edge preparation. So first you understand the purpose of this. Like say when you are working with the thin seeds. Thin seeds means like it is less than say 3 or 5 mm depending upon the metal. When you are working with the thin seeds, maybe application of the heat from the top can facilitate the melting through the thickness without much problem. And so you can develop the fusion weld joint without any difficulty. You may not require any edge preparation. Only thing is that surfaces has to be straight and clean like this, right? So this has to be machined, made square and vertical like this. So this kind of the groove geometry is called square groove. Okay. But when you find that thicker seats are to be joined, so for thin seats, square groove geometry is fine because you can ensure the through thickness penetration, through thickness melting, applying the heat from the top and melting up to the bottom. This is possible only for thin seats. But when your thickness is too high, then maybe heat, in this case what will happen, you are applying the heat from the top using the arc or flame, but you may find that you are not able to melt through the thickness, but you have melted up to certain depth. So this is the section which will be left unmelted, means no welding in this portion. So if this is the case, then what we have to do, we have to make a groove by removing all this unwanted material like this. Okay, so what will be realizing with this, like you will have a situation of this kind like this. So now your heat source now will be able to reach up to the bottom, and then you apply the heat, so the through thickness penetration will be realized here. And then you can keep on depositing now the weld metal like this, okay, to fill up the entire gap. So the another so the one of the main purposes of making the groove is to ensure that you are able to melt and weld and develop the weld throughout the thickness. Otherwise, you without edge preparation, with the square groove geometry in case of thick section plate welding, you are left with some of the unwelded or unmelted portion. So to avoid that situation, so to ensure the through thickness melting, or it is more precisely termed as through thickness penetration, what we do, we prepare the edges. So that your heat source can reach up to the bottom in order to ensure the development of weld joint throughout the thickness. Okay, this is one purpose. The second purpose of the edge preparation is to make the surfaces clean, remove all oxides, paint, oil, dust, dirt, whatever impurities you have at the surfaces, those need to be removed. If they are left, then on thermal decomposition by heat of the arc, either they will form moisture, vapors, water vapors, or they will form some kind of the chemicals present in those impurities will react with the molten metal to form the inclusions. So those will be there in that case as a defect. So in order to avoid the presence of moisture, in order to presence of all those impurities, the surfaces are cleaned. So for cleaning purpose, what we use wire brush, so that all your oxides, rust, etc. is removed. The second thing which is done is we can use the acidic cleaning, acidic or basic cleaning. So, like pickling or HCl or HNO, three kind of acids are also used, diluted acids are used for the cleaning purpose, so that all these impurities are removed from the surface. Otherwise, we can use ethanol or acetone kind of thing also for cleaning purpose. So the edge preparation comprises two things. One is the cleaning and the second is the cutting of the edges, so that you, your heat source can reach up to the bottom in order to ensure the through thickness melting and penetration. Okay, there are different groove geometries which are used for developing the joints. Let's say if the thickness is less, say up to 15 to 25 mm, we work with the single groove geometries. But if the thickness is more, like say more than, depending upon the metal only, that's why there is a range. Otherwise, usually 25, more than 25, we go for the double edge or the double groove preparations. So what is the single groove or double groove geometry preparations? So in case of the square groove, we have to just make the edges of the plate straight and square. This is called square groove geometry, and this is good enough for thin sections, not for thick sections. But if it is like say more than 5 mm, then what we have to do, we have to make the V groove. This is one. So the V, the structure, this, the shape is matching with the V only, that's why it is called V groove geometry. And this is done by either the flame cutting or by machining. Like you can use the shaping, you can use milling like that, or you can also use the grinding if it is a very thin section. Or let's say machining and the flame cutting, these are the two most commonly used methods. So this is called V. So we are making like single groove, just one groove is there. Okay, when our section thickness is more, like say so this single groove geometry is up to like say 15 mm to 25 mm, it's fine. But if thickness is further more, then what we do, the two V groove geometries are made like this. So in this case, so the section thickness is this much. Okay, so the weld will be made first by depositing the metal one side, then other side. So basically it is done alternatively. So what we do, first of all one pass is made this side, then second pass is made other side, then one pass made this side, then other pass other side. So whatever the stresses are being induced, they will be balanced in order to develop the angular distortion free or distortion free weld. So that's how the alternatively one side and other side the weld metal is deposited. So this will be the example of the double V, where the V groove geometry is being made both the sides, top side as well as the bottom side, double V groove geometry. So similarly, we can make the U groove geometry like this, which is matching with the U groove. Okay, and the weld metal is deposited in this manner. We can have the single U or double U like this. So this is an example of the So this is the single U groove geometry and W, single U and W groove geometry. So here if you see, this is the square groove. There is no edge preparation. These are straight and square. This is single V. We are making the V just one side, and this is single U. U is being made. And if you see, when the one V groove geometry is made just one side, means the one V is made and another is straight and square. So this is called bevel.